The Iron Game Chalk Talk podcast is brought to you by the following sponsors: EliteForm.com and IgnitionAPG.com. And now, the Iron Game Chalk Talk podcast. Welcome to Iron Game Chalk Talk with your host, Ron McKeefery.
Every time our athletes walk into this weight room, they're going to be pushed to the max.
Let's go! Let's go! Everything you got!
On this podcast, hear Coach McKeefery's straight talk about training, featuring the top strength and conditioning professionals from around the world. And now, here's your host, Ron McKeefery.
Hey guys, welcome back to Iron Game Chalk Talk. I'm your host, Ron McKeefery, and this is episode number 73. Iron Game Chalk Talk is a weekly podcast where I bring you experts in the field to talk shop each week. If you haven't already done so, please subscribe to us on iTunes or YouTube, or join our mailing list at ronmckeefery.com so you can stay up to date with the latest episodes and anything else we have going on. Excited this week to have Stuart Yule with us. Stuart is the head strength coach for the Glasgow Warriors over in Scotland, and wrote a fantastic chapter in the High Performance Training for Sports book on maintaining in-season conditioning. So I wanted to have him on the show just to talk a little bit about these 10 critical in-season strength training principles or philosophies that he's come up with that I think, you know, where we're at right now for a lot of the strength coaches that are going into the season or about to go into the season would be very applicable. So I know you'll get a ton out of that. Before we do, we want to recognize our sponsors, EliteForm.com and IgnitionAPG.com. Truly appreciate them being a part of the show and helping to continue to bring this to everyone for free. But Ignition is a sports performance company based in Cincinnati, and you know, they have a speed system certification that I took last year that I thought was fantastic. And they got one coming up here November 7th in Cincinnati, or just right outside of Cincinnati. And if you can get to that, I think you would really, truly enjoy it. And there really isn't just a whole lot out there in terms of speed and specifically being focused on the development or having a certification in that. So I think that's the most applicable product they have right now. They have other things. They have, you know, protein, they have a drink, they have some equipment. Obviously, they train elite level athletes, and so they're a great resource as well. But I think the speed certification would be fantastic for everyone to check out. So make sure you go to their website to check that out, as well as their Facebook page and Twitter page and all that stuff. If you enjoy Iron Game Chalk Talk, you'll definitely enjoy Strength On Demand. Strength-ondemand.com is an online archive of strength and conditioning clinic presentations that myself and Rob Taylor put together. And this is, you know, this is the back end here. You know, you're able to log in, go to videos, and it's just 50-plus videos, clinic presentations, that you're able to go through and just pick what you want to do on your time, anywhere you have a Wi-Fi connection. So, or an internet connection. So I would truly encourage you to go to strength-ondemand.com and check that out. But we're always trying to sharpen our sword, and I know that you would appreciate it as much as I did. I wanted to create a product that I would use, and so make sure you check that out. All right, want to get to Stuart. Know you're going to get a lot out of this. Make sure you sit back and take a lot of notes. We'll see you on the other side. All right, guys, real excited to have Stuart Yule with us. Stuart is the head strength coach for the Glasgow Warriors over in Scotland, and it's actually a place that I've been before, so I'm excited to have him on the show. And we met back at the UKSCA conference a couple of years ago, and he wrote a chapter in the High Performance Training for Sports book that we had David Joyce on not too long ago, and just did a fantastic job on his chapter for maintaining an in-season conditioning edge. And wanted to have him on the show just to talk through that and just to get his background, man. So I appreciate you saying it's 12 o'clock over there, 12 p.m. or a.m. So I'm keeping him up late. So truly appreciate you coming on the show, man.
No, it's great. Appreciate you inviting me on, Ron. So good to chat.
Awesome, man. Well, we'll go into it a little bit. Why you got into strength and conditioning in the first place, and then kind of how you got to your current role.
Okay. Well, I started out as an Olympic weightlifter, so from, you know, all through kind of school age, I was Olympic weightlifting. It's kind of in the family. My father was an Olympic weightlifter. My brother also competed. He went to the Olympics. And So that kind of strength side has always been in the family. My mother was a shot putter. We trained in the garage, and then from pretty much 10 years of age, been lifting weights and practicing weightlifting, and then strength and conditioning probably kind of late 90s, early 2000s started to become a profession. And at the time, the Scottish Institute of Sport started, and I started just doing some part-time work for them, and then I trained as a physiotherapist, and I was working part-time as a strength and conditioning coach, graduated in physiotherapy, and worked for a short time as a physio, but then decided that I'd rather take the path of in strength and conditioning, where it's much more, you know, looking at the preventative side, looking much more holistically at getting athletes prepared to avoid injury, improve performance, rather than perhaps on a more reactive side. So I was fortunate enough to get full-time employment with the Scottish Institute of Sport as a strength and conditioning coach. And really that's where my kind of career took off, and worked within the Scottish Institute for a few years. And then I went down to the English Institute of Sport and worked with the GB judo program up to the Olympics. And from then came up to Scotland and I've been with the Glasgow Warriors for the last, you know, this is going to my sixth season. So, so that's kind of been it's been my kind of journey into it. And, you know, still learning all the time, still kind of striving to look for areas we can improve, you know, I would say now our rugby players to perform more optimally, to reduce injury potential, to have the capacity to do their sport to a higher degree every day. So enjoying it still.
Well, you guys are in season, about four games in, and you know, that's kind of what you wrote your chapter on, and I thought it was such a great chapter. And in your chapter on in-season training, you mentioned 10 critical in-season training philosophies, you know, and the first one being kind of having an efficiency in the training process. Mm-hmm. What do you mean by that?
Well, for me as a strength and conditioning coach, we've obviously got a role within the whole performance process, and the physical outcome on the field isn't just dependent on what we do as strength and conditioning coaches. It's about the whole process of training, so their skill work, their technical work, and though that technical work will have a demand, a physical demand on the body, and will have a physical outcome if executed correctly. So for me, it's making sure that whole process is a succinct process that achieves the goal, the performance goal, i.e. they're better when they come game day, and almost appreciate and understand those demands that they go through, so that I'm not replicating the same stimulus that they might have on the rugby pitch. So if they're doing a technical drill that involves a lot of speed or acceleration or agility work, that I'm not then trying to reproduce that. I'm looking at maybe what qualities they need to improve that.
Sure.
And add to that so we're not having 10 of the same stimuluses in the day. It's looking at where the strength program fits in and prioritizing the needs of that athlete on that day, given all the other demands that they have within their training program.
Well, it's such a, you know, it brings up a great point. You know, when I look for assistants, you know, I always try to find assistants that have played, at least for sure, played college sports, just so that they understand the demands of a college athlete. But specifically, I try to find people that have played that sport so that they understand the technical side of things, and they understand the practice and concept conceptually, and they can really contribute in ways. And I think it's such an important point that you bring up, you know, and it kind of goes in hand with, you know, your next point, which was, you know, keeping everything simple, you know, really, you know, in season's not the time to be experimenting, you know? And so, you know, what are some ways that you keep things simple, you know, with your rugby in season program?
Well, as I say, I mean, the demands of the sport of rugby, the same with any sport, the unique qualities that the player needs and the demands of that sport are extremely high. So they're involved in high collisions game day. There's contact work within the week. There's acceleration, deceleration work. So that process is happening, and that's, we've got an extremely good coach where we are. So that's coached and it's manipulated depending on the time of the week, the part of the season. So for me, this almost the strength program backing that up. Let's, you know, keeping it simple in the sense of, if we want to get stronger, there's some key priority lifts and exercises we need to do. There's certain loadings we need to have. So it's not trying to mimic or dilute rugby by by creating some extravagant exercises that maybe could be like rugby. It's keeping the strength program simple to kind of almost maintain that foundation and ensure that their capacity to do their sport remains intact throughout the season. So therefore, you know, it's a very simple strength program. It's manipulated and progressed, you know, individually and through the season and prioritize particular times when we need to taper off or we have particular phases in season where we can increase volume. So it's keeping it as simple as possible, and also simple in the sense that I know it works. So I'm not trying to do things that I'm not sure it could work, or deliver exercises that I don't know could work. And it's the example could be, for example, with another strength coach, could be they might think power cleans could be good, but they might not be able to coach them. So for them, putting them in a program, it might be too complicated because they can't coach it maybe well enough. So it's coaching what you know and coaching it well so that the athlete actually progresses.
You know, I agree with you 100%. And, you know, a lot of times what happens is, you know, whenever you bring the athletes in, you know, there's the, you know, you got half the athletes that want to come train and they get it, and they got half the athletes that are like, it's the last, you know, it's the worst thing in the world and they don't want to do it. And so people throw in these exercises and these random progressions and things like that to try to keep their attention. And it really is just a lack of knowledge or being able to, or relationship with their athletes to be able to get to, for them to understand that this is what we have to do. This is the cost of doing business, you know? Yeah. And so that kind of, you know, it kind of goes in. I mean, because, you know, true strength training, it's hard. It's not easy, you know, and your next principle of strength is the foundation. You know, how do you get that out of your athletes? How do you present that information to them and really, you know, what are the protocols you're using from a strength standpoint? In season?
Well, I think, it's a combination of factors with the athletes. I mean, fortunate enough that I've got a really good group of athletes, the core of them have been with the club is for some of them as long as I've been with the club, and we've kind of evolved together. So I've evolved what I do, and that's my learning has been based on how they've responded. And the core of that, the players I'm working with are a very good responsive group of players that recognize the importance of strength training. They've seen the transfer onto the training pitch and onto game day. And, you know, me in combination with them have then influenced other players that have come in who have had good experience in the past, have been extremely powerful. So, you know, we've got our backs power cleaning, one of our backs is power cleaning 155, and, you know, he then has an influence on some other guys. So there's a real team work, not just me with the players, but the players with each other, you know, as mentors for other players, some of the younger players. So it's very much a real team effort to kind of push that philosophy onto everyone. So a player coming to the club now will recognise that we have a big emphasis on our strength work and the importance of, you know, things being done technically well and on some priority exercises that are done in the gym to get the guys strong. So it's all kind of interlinked. In terms of almost the prescription of the training program, again, taking it to simple, it's almost a hybrid of various learnings that I've had over the years. Mike Stone used to coach me when he was in Scotland, and the estimated microcycles and multiple set work that I used to do, and almost that preparatory kind of almost before that, it was almost the kind of almost Eastern European training methodology or Russian training methodology of kind of a lot of general preparatory work. And then recent influences for me, again, keeping things simple, things like 5-3-1, juggernaut, these kind of programs are very kind of good and well laid out from a, you know, almost a principle of not training to your maximum, training below your ceiling and almost giving someone the ability to keep progressing. And I think because I've applied those strategies, players have progressed through the season, and then in turn they see the value. They, you know, if you're making progress, you want to keep going. And I think that's the important thing of keeping the players have been motivated. They've been motivated themselves to progress. We have, you know, just little things like the PB bell in the gym. So that's being rung, and that again adds value. People now want to get stronger. They want to beat their PBs. So it's almost a, a cycle that just keeps flowing, a flywheel that just keeps going through the season. And we just, one of my aims is to keep it turning. And that's me just always directing it. It's working with the players as well to that they keep it turning and drive each other and competition amongst each other. So it's almost a real, potentially complex with all the variables involved, but it's simple. And I think it's the motivation of everyone to keep pushing to get better. And we've got aims above it in terms of from a rugby performance perspective to be a winning team. And that's not going to happen on its own. Every single thing that happens, what every single player does every day when they come into the training facility is to improve. And the strength part is a big part of that. So it's all part of the whole chain.
Well, the environment is so important, and that's something that we constantly talk about here on the show is coaching the athlete. And, because, again, if you don't get them to do what you want them to do, then the program, it doesn't matter how good it is.
And, that's great.
And not just coaching at them, but coaching with them and incorporating the other athletes is a great point.
Yeah.
You talk about, this, I love the fourth one here, the fourth one being continual improvement, not maintenance. And I hate that word. I hate maintenance word. And I hate that from our coaches. Yeah. I hate it from our players. How do you continually improve, but not, and minimize that word maintain, because there is some detrimental effects to the season, things like that. But you're trying to constantly improve.
Yeah. Well, I think, again, it goes back to the whole philosophy of when we step in the gym, it is to improve. And I think it's not really a strength program. It's not about improving. And if you're providing your body with a stimulus, it will want to improve. Now, the ability for it to improve will depend on all these other variables and the demands that are going through the player. So it's but the actual intent and the aim of it is to improve. And I think the maintenance side for me, when it's talked about, and in my mind, it's more the maintenance is almost people who want to just preserve what the athlete already has. So maintenance isn't strength training. It's just preservation of, if you've got an elite athlete who's explosive and fast, and if a strength coach doesn't want to interfere with that, they might not give them any loads and they just exist as they are, which for some people it might be extremely talented, for others it's not, and that won't be enough for those that need to improve.
Right.
Physically. They need to be on a program that stresses them, obviously, and provides that stimulus to improve. So it's very much, and because our season's so long and pre-season's so short, it's almost we want to continually evolve. And if we want to be at our best at the end of the season, what we do in pre-season, if our pre-season's in July and our finals are in end of May the following year, what we've done pre-season would no way last that length of time. So the process has to be to improve right the way through. So when we come to our finals at the end of the season, we are in our best physical condition possible.
You talk, the fifth principle about sharpening the edge, and then being, that mental focus and that discipline and things like that. What are some of the ways that I know you've been there for a long time and you've changed the culture and a lot of those things kind of take care of themselves. Let's go back to when you were just coming in.
Yeah.
What were some of the things that you did from establishing a culture and teaching the athletes to have a certain type of focus when they walked in the weight room?
Well, my first time in the gym, there was guys kind of just grinding out with 200 kilo squats, and just it looked ugly, and there was no real support around them. Their teammate was maybe sitting on a bench, mm-hmm. looking the other way. If someone did have a desire to improve, there was maybe more of a mocking than a. Team sports will have banter, guys will kind of mess around with each other, but there wasn't necessarily that real support to push on. So the first thing was on for me was to take it right back, make sure that the quality of movement, the intent within the exercise, the focus for not just that person, but the teammates around, so there's spotters in, looking at each other, they're feeding back to each other as well. So it became that, let's have... If there's 20 guys in the gym or 15 guys in the gym, there's 15 coaches as well. So people begin to understand what they're trying to do and what their teammates trying to achieve. And, you know, gradually, you know, over that first year, more and more people kind of, they maybe didn't break what they'd done before, but their reps were better. And then the next year, guys were, you know, guy was grinding out of a 200 kilo squat. We had guys doing 200 kilos well. And,
right.
and that whole process has just evolved. So, say, you know, down the line, a 200 squat isn't a big deal now, whereas before it was. And I think that's come from just the coaching of the athlete, making sure that their teammates support each other. Support right. each other, you know, guys are in spotting, helping each other, and really kind of paying attention to what they're doing, and just little things, the coaching. So for me, it was Mike Stone that taught me about, you know, just regardless how heavy the weight is, you still try and move it as quickly as you can, even if that load isn't moving quick, the intent is always there to move it quick, and that's a massive part of what we do.
I agree.
So it's. And then now it's just a daily regime of training, of progress, of guys encouraging each other. And I'm, you know, still heavily involved, obviously, but I don't have to have the same directed focus with everyone. It's because we've got, as I said before, we've got a lot of guys in there very experienced now as strength athletes. You know, they're rugby players, but they're very good strength athletes now as well.
Sure. You know, your six principles is train in threshold, and, you know, the strain zones below maximal loads, and kind of training maximally and manipulating your intensity based off, you know, different weeks and maybe different competition levels and those types of things. What do you mean by that principle?
Well, it's kind of, it goes back to kind of maybe Jim Wendler's 5-3-1, and, you know, they'll base it off a 90% load, so they'll have their 1 RM, but it's 90% of that. So that's that. It's not training at your ceiling. And so, I mentioned before, when I first started, everyone was grinding out their 200. That's they're at their ceiling, and they're just trying to hit that every time, and not really making progress. And you know, neurally burnout, and with the demands of other training, they weren't making any progress. So it's training below that ceiling. So between kind of. The most of the volume, say lower body, between 75% and 85%, and just there's a progression within that. But each time, without even hitting the ceiling, they'll go up. Now, it's important for me that they do have that intent to apply maximal force. You know, that say a tight forwards who are in scrums who have, you know, it's a very much a real high isometric forces there, that they do have that ability neurally to exert that. So when they feel good, and there's windows where they can push up for their 1 RM, but but that's rare. It's maybe every third block that they'll do that, rather than every block or every week like before. They'd want to just go heavy and kill themselves. So they're training hard, but it's between that rep range. And then in terms of deload weeks, I mean, some of the weaker guys might not even need to deload for a period of time. But some of our stronger guys, the guys that are playing, will be deloading generally before fourth week. But sometimes, depending on fixtures, we have sometimes have a 7-day turnaround, sometimes we have a 5-day turnaround between games. And that will be just manipulated depending on where those fixtures are. And then generally go through three blocks of four. So start off just in the just general principle of a slightly higher volume in the first block, and we'll always go back to that because it's such a long season.
Yep.
It'll kind of come back to more of a general preparatory kind of block, then go into, you know, more kind of strength realization, so it's lower volume, and then the last block is third block is when they want to go up for a couple of singles, heavier singles, keep the volume low, and, you know, that's when they realize some PBs. On some of their lifts.
Sure. The your seventh one was coach the athlete, and that's something that I couldn't agree with more. You know, because like you mentioned, you know, you're in the fourth week, somebody's coming off of an injury, somebody maybe coming off a bad game, something along those lines. I mean, you're dealing with, you know, different body types, different training ages, different training motivation. What are some of the things that you do, you know, within a week to train, you know, to coach that athlete through their training for the week?
I mean, the first thing for me is just talking to them and understanding them as an athlete and knowing, you know, again, just observing them in the gym if they're power cleaning and I know they're capable of particular weight, but on warm-up weights, it's looking slow, it's looking sluggish, they're taking longer to warm up. There's big flags for me there that, you know, it might be their time just to back off a little bit. If, however, on the other hand, you know, they're flying out of a weight on a squat or power clean or a lift and it's looking easy and it's moving well and they maybe haven't played at the weekend, you know, it could be, well, let's kind of push it up a bit. This could be your window just to kind of go the next step. So it's very much that observation and say understanding that athlete and how they respond. And now a lot of them will come and just speak to me before the session saying, I want to go for this today, I want to do that. And then, okay, let's have a look at you, you warm up, let's see how you're getting on. And I'd say that's, for me, is the biggest one. And you know, so say it is the same, like we plan our strength blocks and our programs, and that's maybe planned 4 weeks out, 5 weeks out. So, you know, we can plan it, but as you say, there's so many things that come into play in season that we don't know what they're going to be like on that given day. We've planned 80% for five sets of three or three sets of five. It could be that load is too light, it's too heavy. Potentially, the exercise might need to be modified slightly that given day. So it's very much big time is just watching the athlete and observing them and understanding them.
You know, the next two kind of go hand in hand. You know, you have what, which is a principle of mine. I have, you know, you had 10, your training philosophies. I have 10 principles that I kind of designed by, but, you know, variation is definitely a principle for me. And, you know, that's the spice of life. That's how you keep things fresh and not just in modalities and exercises and things like that, but also in your ninth principle, you talk about creating training blocks. Yeah. And incorporating deload weeks, you know, and unloading sometimes is as beneficial as anything. I mean, I'll go back to my first couple training programs, first couple years in coaching, and it was very much just a straight linear periodization model and going, you know, and I didn't really, you know, I didn't really give them the rest to be able to, or the deload weeks. And now I build it off everything off of 3 week loaded blocks and an unload week. Okay. And that doesn't mean you stop training. That just means that you reduce some of the volume. But talk a little bit about, you know, how you go about creating your training block and you know, and what are some of the things that you really focus on in those deload weeks to make it so that the athletes don't take advantage of the week.
Yeah. I mean, say with different players, the deloads are different, and you know, for some, it's a complete reduction in volume and intensity. Our kind of high neural guys, you know, it might be, and you know, with those guys, it'll be a complete deload. You know, there won't be anything really that explosive in the week. Loading will be kind of 60% on squats maybe and just something so they don't get DOMS when they come back, basically. So it's just some movement and a bit of stress. But the other guys that need to almost keep training, it is a deload, but it's almost it's more of a variation so that they kind of maintain a volume, but there's maybe some a bit more single leg work in that day, lighter loads. They'll still keep a volume. They might not do kind of almost heavy bench press, for example, but might be more dumbbell work and keeping a level of volume that they can kind of keep a muscle mass stimulus in there. And then for others that are maybe almost, they need to keep doing something. You know, you've got guys that need to train, otherwise they lose very quickly. They'll maybe back off and it could be because the rest of the volume is low that week, kind of towards the end of the week, they might go up for a single or something. And it won't be in a squat, for example, but it might be a push press or something where they feel that, you know, I feel good. I want to, again, take that next step and it's their window to progress. So that could be in that deload week. So everything's really low. They'll have one stimulus, which is, you know, is big neural stimulus, but it's one in that week, and it's and because everything else is so low, I've got no problems with them getting the air and that right to do it. But if by feeling good, by moving well, by no niggles, and then they push that on, and then they're back into kind of full training the following week.
Oh, that's good. That's smart. You know, your last principle. You talk about aiming to increase strength potential, not peaking. You know, in a sport like ours, you go week to week. You know, some sports go multiple competitions within a week, and it's hard to get to that. You know, to where you're really peaking for one specific event. You know, what do you mean when you talk about increasing strength potential versus peaking?
Well, so it's. For me, it is the potential. So let's say coming from a sport of weightlifting where the competition was snatch and clean and jerk, and obviously it's massive important that your top weightlifters are extremely strong. So they have big back squats, big pressers. So it's, but that isn't the sport. So, you know, I'd lose to guys that I could squat more than. So,
right.
So for me, the strength training program is the potential. It doesn't mean you're going to be better at rugby. And it doesn't mean we have to realize it all the time in the gym. So it's important to be realizing that on the pitch. But the unfortunate thing for a player or for a coach is that we can't measure it. We don't know what they squatted on the pitch on Saturday.
Right.
But what they expressed was a PB, or was a 230 squat, was a 220 squat. But we just can't measure it because it's not in the weight
room. Nice, wouldn't it?
But for example, we had a game that was cancelled last year, and so we took the guys in the gym, and so just an example, anecdotally, one of our players, he PB'd on his squat. So his strength potential was increasing, and he realised some of that through a squat on the Friday when the game was cancelled. So if he played, he'd have taken that onto the pitch, and that's what we wanted. But in terms of, so that's that strength potential. We want to build that base that they might never realise what they're truly capable of because they're rugby players and they've got some of the demands. Mm-hmm. But in terms of the peaking, you know, after a peak comes a trough, and we don't necessarily want a trough. There might be periods where we can afford to push some individuals if they're being rested from playing and they kind of to go up to that next kind of strength level that we push that, and there's a little, because of the demands on them, they'll kind of fade off a little bit after. But it's say from the start of last season, some players went from the start of pre-season to the end of the season was 51 weeks. So it's such a long period of time. And because we're not necessarily fully realizing what they're capable of, we want to just keep building that potential.
Right.
And after that, after a peak comes a trough. So we don't want them in season. And what we'll do is just manipulate volume that they're fresher so they can realize some more of that come game day. And now the biggest peak for us would be if we get to finals, but we have to get to the finals first. So we don't want to be crashing off or guys falling off before we get there. And then because we've then got a semi-final, a final, we're definitely not going to peak them. But what we're doing is all the time raising their potential. So come game day, come finals, what their potential is superior to where they were at the beginning of the season. That what they walk around that at a minimum is now extremely good and extremely strong and powerful.
Right.
And we don't almost have to worry. So their minimum now is a 200 squat, whereas 4 months ago it was a 180. They might be capable of a 220 or a 230, but you know that, and we'd hope they would be if their minimum with under fatigue, under stress is a 200. But so that's that kind of almost that general principle of potential, and almost their adaptive level is just a higher level rather than what actually they are capable of.
Sure. Well, you go on to, you know, give templates and break down different periodization models and things like that in the chapter, and I'd highly encourage everybody to read that and to check that out. But you know, we want to get into some resources here on the show like we usually do. And you know, what's the best piece of coaching advice that you've ever received?
I've been fortunate enough to work with some good people and some good coaches. It's a tricky one in terms of best.
Or just one that you go back to.
I mean, the one thing for me is technical mastery, and it's within technical mastery there will be a development of whatever qualities that technical mastery requires. So, from a strength perspective, technical mastery will allow you to continue to explore new strength levels every week, every year. And then technical mastery then to create transfer into the field of the sport you want, will develop the specific physical qualities within the sport.
That's great.
And I think for me, that's the fundamental thing that I need to kind of sticks with me in terms of what I'm trying to achieve.
All goes back to the rep, right? You got to perform it the correct way for you to be able to get the most out of it. What's a quote that you either have flashed up in your weight room or something that you live by?
We've got quite a few quotes in our weight room. And, you know, it's almost the one that kind of sticks in my mind is the harder you work, the harder it is to surrender. Yeah. And we've got a lot that are about that preparation and the importance of working hard when no one's watching, when you're, you know, it's about what you do yourself from within that pushes you to the limits. And then when it comes to competition day, you're prepared and ready, and it's never easy. It's not, you know, we wouldn't want to say, no, it's going to be easy, because then it's the wrong mentality, but the hard work has been done.
Sure. What about, you know, we got a bunch of young strength coaches that listen to the show, and you know, all of us really are always constantly lifelong learners. That's what makes strength coaches great. But what give us it doesn't have to be a strength conditioning resource, but, you know, give us a book that you recommend, an app, and a website.
A book, well, obviously, high performance training for sports.
Right.
I mean, I think, you know, from terms of, say, just
I've
got
book.
A chapter in it, there we go. But I think as a resource, it's out currently.
Yeah, it's a great one.
There's a lot of good areas in it, and it's pitched at a level for people who are experienced and those that are just trying to get into the field. It's a good insight into lots of areas within sports performance. In terms of other book, I mean, I kind of, you know, it's almost even little things that have stuck in my mind. There's a book called The Goal by Eli Goldratt, which is a business book, but it's about really establishing what is the goal of things and what is where constraints within your whole process. I read that years ago and around what I'm doing. That's where I kind of came about that philosophy of keeping things simple and almost addressing the whole process and the outcome on game day isn't just, you know, there could be constraints within what I'm doing, but it's also looking at the bigger picture of
I agree.
What you're looking at. In terms of an app, this is probably where we're behind the times. There probably isn't an app at the moment that I'm using. You know, that's an area that for me is where we can improve, is using more apps to kind of for our wellness scores for things like that. I know that I was just down at my brother's. He's he was at the Olympics, and he's had performance director for British weightlifting, and he's with his own training. He's using the Big Lifts 2 to track his training. It's got a 5-3-1 app on there, and
yeah,
I saw that and I thought, right, I need to do that again. Keeps it simple. Keeps tracking your program, your reps. It's a nice little tool to something like that, just to keep on track. And what was the last one? Sorry, Ron.
Website that you maybe go to and check out regularly.
Yeah, I'm on Twitter and Facebook, and Twitter for me is an excellent resource for following, you know, guys like yourself and others that put up resources. I think, and you know, probably the last kind of couple of years or last year, that's where I've been my go-to to followed decent coaches and the researchers, sports scientists, that put up a lot of really good information that's out there.
Well, you're absolutely right, and that's, you know, social media, for a long time there, I thought it was the Antichrist, you know, I thought it was the worst thing in the world, but there really is. I mean, if you really use it with the intent to become a better strength coach, you can definitely get a lot out of it and connect with people around the world, and that's what's great about this, man, having the opportunity to talk to an established strength coach, successful strength coach like yourself, halfway across the world here, and talk shop and learn from each other, and can't thank you enough for, you know, staying up late and hanging out with us and talking a little shop and for writing the chapter in the book. I agree with you. I think it's high performance training for sports is a must get for people right now. I think it's a great book. And it's got a little bit of everything in it. And I appreciate you taking the time to write specifically about in-season strength and conditioning, because I think it's the hidden gem. I mean, I talk to our coaches all the time about this is the longest period of uninterrupted training that we have. You know? And so we need to be able to take advantage of it. And I think a lot of the things that you wrote about in there, specifically the 10 critical training philosophies, were a great way of kind of bringing your program into a checklist per se, you know, and just making sure that you're touching base on things. And I think that that's something that as strength coaches, there's so many, you know, we're like mice sometimes. You see a flashing thing over here, and sometimes you go and you jump and you just want to change it up a little bit, but you got to stay true to what you believe and your principles and your philosophies and things along those lines, and then find ways to add variety and things like that in your program. So it really struck a chord with me, and I really wanted to have you on the show just to talk to people about it. But I truly appreciate it, man.
No, great. Thanks for having me on, Ron. It was good to chat, and happy to share.
Great, buddy. Thanks a lot.
All right.
That's it for this episode of Iron Game Chalk Talk. Thanks to this week's guest, as well as our sponsors, EliteForm.com and IgnitionAPG.com, for bringing this episode to you for free. Make sure to check out RonMcKeefery.com, where you can join our mailing list, find the show notes, including all the links and resources mentioned, and information about Coach McKeefery's other products. While you are there, please join Coach McKeefery in the comments section thanking our guest for sharing. If you haven't subscribed to Iron Game Chalk Talk on YouTube or iTunes yet, make sure to do so. Comments, ratings, and reviews are always welcome. Coach McKeefery can be found on Twitter at @RMcKeefery, on Facebook and YouTube at @Ron.McKeefery. That's it for this week. Be sure to check back next week for another great episode of Iron Game Chalk Talk.